Hey everybody, this is Rishi Agarwal, and in this video, I'm going to go over how I look at a chest CT. This video is intended for radiology residents who are starting out on their chest rotation, but if you're a trainee in pulmonology or in thoracic surgery, you'll probably find some of this information useful as well. All right, now the first thing that I look at before I even look at the CT is the scout image. And the reason is a lot of times the scout image covers more than you'll see on the axial images. So you might pick up something in the abdomen or in the neck on the scout that you won't see on the axial chest CT images. So it's very important to look at the scout image on every patient. The next thing I do is go to the soft tissues. So I'll pull up the soft tissues and I'll start with the supraclavicular region. And I'll usually make sure that I'm on the right window and level. So I'm using the abdomen windows here because I want to accentuate the difference between the fat and the soft tissues. And the first thing I look at is the thyroid gland. Now the thyroid gland is right here and I'm making sure that it's not enlarged and that it doesn't have any nodules in it. But you don't have to follow up every nodule. I usually use the ACR guidelines on whether to follow up a nodule, which is based on size and the age of the patient. The next thing I do is look for lymph nodes. So the supraclavicular region can be tricky because there are a lot of vessels that are coursing in and out of the area, and you have the scalene muscles, which can be confused for lymph nodes. So it's important to scroll up and down and take your time in this area when you're starting out to make sure that if you're calling a lymph node, that it's a lymph node and not a muscle or a vessel. And you can use your coronal images to help you. So if you localize things with your coronal images, then the vessels will show up as vertically oriented structures and lymph nodes will show up more as nodules. So after looking at the supraclavicular region, I then look at the subpectoral and axillary regions, also looking for enlarged lymph nodes. So for example, there is a small lymph node right there. Now I usually wouldn't measure a lymph node of this size, but just for demonstration purposes, what you want to do is take the long axis, so go from one end to the other end, and then take a measurement that's orthogonal to the long axis. So it's actually too small right now, but it's really hard to do it on this small lymph node, but like that. That would be orthogonal to the long axis. So this lymph node is 5.6 millimeters in size. That's probably actually an over measurement. But that's how you measure lymph nodes when you're starting out. As you get more used to measuring lymph nodes, then it's okay to just measure the short axis straight away. But for the axillary lymph nodes, I use a measurement of 10 millimeters. So a 10 millimeters or greater means that that lymph node is enlarged. And that's a general rule for most of body imaging, chest and abdomen. You use a short axis of 10 millimeters as your cutoff. Okay. But the next thing I look at is the internal mammary artery and vein region. And this is the internal mammary artery and that's the vein. And I'm looking also for lymph nodes in this area. And this area is a little bit different from lymph nodes in other areas because I don't use my 10 millimeter cutoff for this area. Any lymph node really is abnormal, but in general, I use a cutoff of 4 millimeters for the internal mammary area to determine whether that lymph node is enlarged or not. And then I scroll down, keep going down, and I look at the lymph nodes in the anterior diaphragmatic region here, looking for enlarged lymph nodes. And there I do, again, use a 10 millimeter cutoff. And then I go all the way down to the last image, and I look at the area around the aorta and the esophagus. So the paraesophageal and paraaortic regions, looking for lymph nodes. This is the azygous vein right here. And I scroll up until I reach the subcarinal region, which is right there. This is what a normal subcarinal lymph node looks like. I then look at each hilum. So I follow each bronchus out and make sure that there are no enlarged lymph nodes in either the right hilum or in the left hilum. Now I'll tell you that the right hilum usually has a lymph node right here. And that lymph node can be a little bit big. It's usually like 9 or 10 millimeters. and that's okay. Like this lymph node is 9 millimeters, and that's okay. Usually that lymph node is about that size. And if you don't see any other abnormalities in the mediastinum, like no other enlarged lymph nodes, and you don't see anything in the lung that can be causing lymph node enlargement in that right hilum, then I would just ignore that finding, because I've learned from experience that that lymph node is just normally 9 to 10 millimeters in size, okay? The left hilar lymph nodes are not that size. Those are reliably pretty small. So if you see a 9 or 10 millimeter lymph node in the left hilum, that's something that you should point out, and that's abnormal. Then I continue up looking at the paratracheal region and the esophagus, looking for enlarged lymph nodes there, up until I get to the thoracic inlet. Then I go back down looking at the anterior mediastinum. And here I have some normal thymic tissue, and I know it's normal tissue because it's soft tissue interspersed with little bits of fat in it. So that means that this is normal, benign thymus and not like a thymic mass or a lymph node. Then I look at the heart and great vessels. So I usually measure them, and I have the measuring tool open. So I usually measure the pulmonary artery right here, and it has to be orthogonal to the long axis. And that's 28, and I usually measure the aorta about right there, and that's 33. So you should follow your own institutional guidelines regarding the threshold limits for the pulmonary artery and the aorta, but I use about 30 millimeters for the pulmonary artery and 40 millimeters for the aorta. But you should pull your attendings and see what numbers they use to determine whether or not these vessels are enlarged. Since this is a chest CT with contrast, I want to look inside of the pulmonary arteries, following each lobar and segmental artery out as best as I can to make sure that there are no filling defects in the pulmonary arteries, okay? Because occasionally you will find incidental pulmonary emboli on these patients. After I'm done with the great vessels, I look at the heart. So first I start with the coronary arteries to make sure that there's no coronary calcium. Now, this is a patient who has contrast on board, so it's a little bit harder to tell whether there's coronary calcium, but you should definitely mention it if you see it. And then I look at the heart itself, looking at each chamber, making sure that it's not enlarged and that there's no filling defects. The left atrial appendage is a common place to get thrombus formation, but not all filling defects that you see on CT equate to thrombus. You can get unopacified blood from eddy currents, as well as trabeculation of the muscle causing filling defects. And the same is true of the right atrium. You can have unopacified blood coming in from the IVC, mixing in with the opacified blood from the SVC, and that can cause mixing artifact in the right atrium. And it's important not to confuse mixing artifact with a filling defect. While I'm looking at the left atrium, I'm also looking at the 4 pulmonary veins and making sure that they're not stenosed or occluded, which can occur after pulmonary vein isolation and other procedures. And then I'm done looking at the heart. After I'm done with the heart, I look at the pericardium to make sure that there's no effusion, pericardial thickening, or calcification. Next, I look at the pleural surfaces on soft tissue windows. And here I'm looking mainly for pleural effusions, pleural nodules, thickening, or pleural calcification. And we'll have another chance to look at the pleura when we go to the lung windows, but I like to look at it first on soft tissue windows before I move on. After I'm done with the pleura, then I look at the abdomen. So the first thing I do in the abdomen is look at the liver. It's really important when you're looking at the liver to narrow the windows, because lesions in the liver can look like normal liver parenchyma. So if you narrow the windows, you will enhance that contrast between the abnormal lesions and the normal liver parenchyma. Now, the liver commonly has incidental small lesions like this, which can be cysts or hemangiomas or other benign lesions. And if the patient doesn't have any known malignancy or cirrhosis, I tend to ignore those, or I put them in the report and call them too small to characterize. After looking at the liver, I then look at the adrenal glands, so the right adrenal gland, right kidney, left adrenal gland, then I look at the spleen. Then I look at the distal esophagus, then stomach. I'll follow that around to the duodenum, then the pancreas. And then the gallbladder. After looking at all of those organs, I then look for lymph nodes. So first in this gastrohepatic ligament region, then here in the splenic hilum, retroperitoneum, then in the liver hilum. I then look at the bowel, including the colon, what we see of it, and the small bowel. Okay, so I think the abdomen is fine. So the next thing I do is look at the bones. So I'm going to change the window, put it on bone windows, go all the way to the bottom, and start looking at the vertebral bodies. So here on the axials, I am looking for sclerotic lesions, lytic lesions, and it makes a big difference if you know that the patient has cancer, because, you know, a sclerotic lesion in a patient without cancer, if it's small, it's probably a bone island. Now, if the patient has prostate cancer, then you might not just blow off small sclerotic lesions as bone islands. You would probably call them suspicious for metastatic disease. So after I've looked at the vertebral bodies, I look at the ribs. So the ribs can be tricky because they go in and out of the plane. So I usually take it one quadrant at a time. So I'll look at the anterior right ribs first, going from top to bottom, looking for fractures or lytic lesions or sclerotic lesions, and then the right posterior ribs. And I usually take that from the bottom up. And then I'll look at the left side, the left anterior ribs, and then the left posterior ribs from the bottom up. After looking at the ribs, I then look at each clavicle. So there's the left, there's the right, then I look at the sternum, then the scapula, there's the right scapula, right humerus, left scapula. Then before moving on to the soft tissues, I look at the sagittal images, and I want to make sure that there are no compression deformities that I missed on the axials. So I look very closely at the sagittal images, especially in the midline, to make sure that there's no compression deformities or any other abnormalities that I may have missed on the axial images. Okay, so that covers the bones. Then I move on to the soft tissues. So the first thing I do is look at the spinal canal. Now this is a low yield place. Rarely will you see anything in the central canal in these patients, but sometimes you can see Mets or lymphoma here. And if you do see that, then those are big consequences to the patient. So even though it's low yield, it's an important place to look for abnormality. Then I look at the anterior soft tissues, including the muscles and the subcutaneous fat. Now this is a male, but he has a little bit of gynecomastia bilaterally. And then I look at the posterior soft tissues, including the subcutaneous fat and the muscles. Get rid of those. Okay, so we've covered the bones and the soft tissues. Now it's time to look at the lungs. So let's pull up the lung windows. And I usually start with the airways. So the first thing I do is make sure that the trachea and the central airways are all clear. So I follow each airway out to its lobar and segmental bronchi and make sure that I don't see anything in the airways. And I have a video showing you the segmental anatomy on CT. If you don't know the segmental anatomy, it's really important to learn that, because you want to make sure that you can localize things in the lungs based on the segment that it's in, not just the lobe. Once I've cleared the airways, then I look at the lungs. Now I do two different passes of the lungs. The first is I look at both lungs looking for big things like consolidations or masses or large areas of ground glass opacity. This is sort of my macro search for disease. And I could tell already that this patient's lungs are basically normal. And the second pass that I do is a more fine pass looking for lung nodules. And this can be a tedious process, but with some practice, you can get pretty fast at looking for lung nodules. And the way I like to do it is scroll down a couple, then up one, scroll down a couple, then up one. And I want to keep the mouse moving so that I'm not staying on one image for too long. Because when you stay on one image, any vessel can mimic a pulmonary nodule. But if you keep the image moving like this, going down two, up one, down two, up one, then you can look for nodules a lot easier because they'll tend to pop out at you. The vessels look like vessels and the nodules look like nodules. Now I do this for each lung and I usually split it up into quadrants. So I'll do the right anterior lung and then the right posterior lung, then the left posterior lung, then the left anterior lung. Now, if you have MIP images can be very helpful for looking for lung nodules. Without going too much into detail, it makes the vessels look like branching long tubular opacities, and it makes nodules look like nodules. So if you have MIP images, then you can use those to look for nodules, or your institution might subscribe to other software packages that can help look for nodules like LungCAD or vessel subtraction software. All right, after looking for nodules, then my job is done. During this whole process, I've been dictating the abnormalities that I see, and it would be at this time that I read my findings and summarize them in my impression. Okay, thanks a lot. I hope this has been helpful for you, and if you have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment below.